choose from the menu, and I chose timeline of that the most tragic period of our history. Like in the case of Komitas, we had the timeline of one person. Here you see the timeline of a whole nation, starting from 1877, when our first Armenian, for the first time, Armenian question was put into international affairs, and this was after Russian-Turkish War of 1878 in San Stefano and then in Berlin Congresses. Here you see the first Armenian delegation participating in Berlin Congress, and then the whole history of the issue, how it evolved from early massacres of 1890s, and then with the construction of Berlin-Baghdad Railroad. Here you see the story, true story, how things happened. In 1910, there was already a written business plan for the deportation of Armenians, written by Germans, who were building the railroad, and it was a pure business plan, and nothing, no killings, nothing. They were considering the authors of that plan were not anti-Armenian in a sense that they were very much pro-Armenian and against Turks, because they were considering that Ottoman Empire is going to disappear and this railroad will create another German colony in Middle East, and in that colony the role of Armenians will be most important. That's why they wanted to move Armenians from Armenian highlands to the railroad, so that will they were very entrepreneurial, they will create new jobs, everything will be, and Armenians were considered the only nation in Ottoman Empire that could do that. So in that sense, it was pro-Armenian in brackets, but in reality, that move and that business plan just gave an idea to Turks, which was used in the most brutal way during First World War. And even during the war, though Germans were allies with Turkey, some Germans were protesting that the Armenians which were deported were being killed and destroyed in the deserts. So they couldn't imagine the brutality that could happen. And German missionaries were trying to change the minds of Armenians not to resist, because they were not imagining that Armenians would be killed. We know many German missionaries who just did everything so Armenians will not resist. And it was not because they were thinking that this is against their interest only. But I want to show you some of the photographs that usually when we are speaking about genocide, we are forgetting about Adana massacres. This is the ruins of the city in 1909, after the massacres and the burned city of Adana. And here are photographs which are much more emotionally influential than the photographs that we have seen from 1915. And after having these horrible massacres, Armenians were not wise enough to understand what could happen to them. And what happened in 1915, I'm not saying that it is, of course, Turkey which has to be blamed, but the collective power of Armenians in 1915, just some figures, there were about 10 million Turks and 5 million Armenians living in the world at that time. We have billionaires like Mantashev, whose wealth was about $1 billion. He was among the most influential people of his time. And he died in 1912. And out of his old wealth, Armenians got peanuts. I mean, we as a nation were very strong, but we were not in, we were not organized, politically very naive. We were thinking that by economic power we can solve political issues, which was not right. Whereas Turkey, which almost lost the war, they managed to recreate a new country, and that's important to take into account when we are looking on the affairs today. Here you can see some of the pictures of deportation. This is for the first time published by us. There was a huge archive of American photographs from Near Eastern relief, and that archive was blown up in 1920s in the United States. And we found the copies of those photographs, some of the copies, this is one of them. Nobody even could imagine that some samples could have been saved. And this is one of those rare American photographs showing the real picture of deportation in Van. Here are very interesting photographs, thousands of them. I'm trying to go directly to the photographic archive now, but one photograph from the timeline is worth showing you. This is Armenian-Turkish friendship in 1908, after Turkish Revolution. Very much like the rapprochement that is happening now between Turkey and Armenia. And here you can read in Turkish and Armenian, Azatutyun, Havasarutyun, Artarutyun, the slogans of French Revolution, freedom, equality, and justice. And poor Armenians were believing that with this brotherhood will bring them fruits, like they are thinking now, some Armenians in power in Armenia, that without solving the issue of genocide, we could create brotherhood with Turkey and Turkish people. I want to go to the photo book. Here is exactly the types of photographs which I'm going to show you. I spoke earlier. The Western Armenian settlements. These are Armenian cities before 1915. In Western Armenia and in other parts of Ottoman Turkey. This is, for example, the town of In Bayazet, Old Bayazet. Now you have seen maybe many of such kind of pictures, images, but this is again the difference that technology is making. You can see the quarters. This is impossible to see in books. You can see the details. The details of architecture. This is a mosque, but in the forms you can understand that this is built by Armenians. And interestingly enough, you know, this mosque is a medium between the heaven and the city, the town. And Armenians were building, you know, mediums. They have lost the connection with heaven, so the town is connected with heaven through this mosque, though they are Armenians. This is very symbolic. They were not believing that they could have a direct connection. So here you see all sorts of Armenian towns in different parts of Turkey, but I want directly to go to Armenian faces. There are thousands of photographs here, so I'm not going to show all of them. Here you will see different stratas of Armenian population. These are Armenian officers serving in Ottoman Empire in 1914, after First World War. And here you see the faces of Armenian officers in 1914. They couldn't imagine what will happen just in several months. You remember that Armenians were, you know, Armenian men were mobilized and most of them killed. This is a family of an Armenian intellectual in the beginning of century. You can read in the captions all the details. This is Armenian writer Ruben Zartarian with his family. He was arrested and exiled and killed later. This is his wife. As you see, you know, different groups, sports people, artists, theater, or here is one of my favorites. I'm usually showing this during demonstrations. This is an Armenian family from Bafra in the beginning of 90s. Out of the whole family, only one woman survived. And here you see the faces and the details of their dressings. So this economic prosperity doesn't help. Or another family, a peasant family. Look on the faces, please. These aristocratic faces are wearing such kind of... These are very simple Armenians. Now tell me, please, have you met recently in Los Angeles or in Armenia such beautiful faces? Where are they? This is another facet of the genocide. And another group of faces. These are Armenian artists. Adamyan, Petros Adamyan. These are Armenian theatrical groups. Women artists. This is Aznif Racha. Armenians have forgotten the names. But for 50 years, from 1850, when the first theaters were established in Turkey, until the beginning of century, until 1915, there were only Armenian artists in Turkey, in Istanbul. No Turks, no Greeks. All theaters were run by Armenians. Not every photograph, because there are some copies. When we have copies, you cannot zoom in. But if you have the original photograph, then there is the possibility to zoom into the face. This is another Armenian artist, women artist. This is actress. I'm sorry. This is Siranush. She was compared with Sarah Bernard in the beginning of century. You see her playing Hamlet in an Ottoman setting. Can you imagine a woman playing a man in the beginning of century in Istanbul? And here I'm going directly to the survivors. You saw the life, some of the stratas, and here is the life afterwards. These are Armenian orphanages in Gyumri, in Egypt, in Echmiadzin. This is the state of the nation. and these are Armenian camps. The first camps established in Syria. This is how Armenians were living right after genocide. This is the first church established in Syria. These are the first schools established in Syria, and you see the space. There is lack of space, so children, they have built a second store in the same room. And this is how Armenians were getting out of the terrible collapse that happened to us. But they were reading Armenian books. They were studying Armenian letters. They are doing everything to keep their identity, and it helped us to survive, because we were trying to keep the type of identity that we have got from our ancestors. Of course, after a while, Armenians started to build their houses, first from wood, then from stone, and after a while, you know, just in a couple of decades, they managed to create in the same countries like Syria a different environment. And here we have the quarters, Armenian quarters. But there is another photograph I want to show you. This is a photograph which we found and we are publishing for the first time. I want to show you in detail. Look on the faces of these children. On the type of movements, you know, how she is keeping herself. And you can imagine that these children speak several languages, you know. And now look here. This is what one photograph can speak about. I mean, you can have hundreds of pages, and you have hundreds of pages of witness accounts in this CD. But this is different. These visuals, you can never have it in a book. But here we have another page, and this is very important. To show to our young generation that we have survived also because we were radical enough to take arms and to defend ourselves. And here you see children who were volunteers, who were voluntarily entering Russian army, French army, and here you see some of the pictures of those children as well. And this is exactly because of such children and such nation that we survived alone in 1918, when all the world has forgotten about us, and we gave the Battle of Sardarabad, and we won. We survived and we created the First Republic exactly because we believed to our own forces that we can establish ourselves without any big power, our country. And I'm telling this because we in Armenia now are approaching to a very important point in the instability that is arising in Middle East, and we need to be very careful so that history will not repeat again. We have to be prepared for a very tragic turn again in the region. This instability which is happening is next door to our borders. We have to realize how important it is to get rid of the oligarchs that are ruling in Armenia. Those responsible, another chapter, just faces. faces. You saw some other faces, Armenian faces. Now have a look on Turkish faces of the beginning of century. This is Turkish army. Cultural genocide, another page, which we have heard a lot stories about Armenian monasteries destroyed, say 2,000 out of 2,200 monasteries, there are only 200 or 300 left, ruins of 200 or 300 left, and about 600,000 pieces of cultural icons being taken from Armenian churches and homes, and but what does it mean in real qualities? We try to bring a visual way of representing the some of those saved items, and from different regions there is an interactive map. I choose Sis in Cilicia, and here you see just one item. This is an item. Out of 600,000 items, there is a number of several hundred, maybe, items which have been saved. This is an item. Or in Sis, there was a complex of monasteries, and here you see 1915, the state of the art of the buildings, and this is it now. And in this way, you are comparing all monuments. There are profound cultural monuments, so you can compare the state in the beginning of century, like this one, and this one now, or this one. Can have a look on this one. Or churches converted to mosques, into mosques. This is all, this belongs to the definition of genocide. International definition of genocide includes also cultural dimension, when you are absorbing the culture of another ethnic group. I want to show some of the same cultural values so you would really appreciate the new medium's power. This is a door from a whole monument, a monastery of Surkarapet, Meşhur Surkarapet. Look on the work of the art of the door. It's very, very difficult to really estimate what memories have been lost by Armenians in 1915, what heritage we have had, and what is saved out of that. This is a piece which maybe many of you have seen in books, but have a look on the work, and you are zooming into the work. And These are just samples of saved goods. Of course, we have many chapters here. I don't want to show all of them. The last chapter which I am showing is Turkish Confession, an unfinished Turkish Confession. We have gathered for the first time in one place all Turkish confessions starting from 1915, and there were confessions in 1915. For example, we start with Ahmet Reza, which was one of the founders of Young Turkish Party. And in 1915, in Parliament, in his speech of September 21st, he was mentioning that nobody has the right to seize another's properties. It is illegal what is happening in Turkey. And there are many, many interesting speeches in Parliament done by Turks. It didn't help, but there were Turks, brave Turks, even at that period of time. And here we have gathered all the confessions, starting from 1915, 1916, 1918, the trial that happened in Istanbul, and all the those accused, how they were, you know, speaking what they have done, and so on, up to 2005, when it was produced. You can see here Turks speaking and confessing. We do not have much time. I already spent almost twice the time which was given to me. So thank you for your attention. And I'm finishing with this last song.
Anushkun ga karkanotsi oro oro amperume Balikin karorer orar.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Gary. This was really enlightening. There are CDs available if anyone is interested. I also want to thank Shahan Natali Foundation, because without the or this organization, they facilitated Garik's trips to the United States and elsewhere. So thank you, Ara, for the driving force, and thank you, Silva. And we have a small reception. Thank you.
And I want to thank Maggie Gershin and Shahan Natali Foundation for making this possible to have this series of presentations in the United States. Thank you.